K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If you're vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
Game On, where progressives fear us and rhinos tremble. Welcome to the political jungle. I'm J.D.
This is Stacy. No one is safe. No one is spared.
Lock up the children.
And the old folk.
Welcome to the world of libservative conservatarians.
Good morning, 1360 WNWNWNJC in that Philadelphia, Southern Jersey, Northern Delaware. JD and Stacey here, sitting on the wrong side, I think, of the radio table. Would that not be correct, Rick? Are we going to have our guest sitting back there?
Yeah, you guys are on the wrong side. I'm going to let you jump back here. And of course, this is a little bit of an impromptu here at Conservative Commanders. So I'll let you drop those mics and come around here, and I'll vacate this seat while you're coming around here. But again, we're coming to you live from the Conservative Political Action Conference in Washington, D.C. I'm Rick Trader, and we're making a quick shift change here. And J.D., I'll let you, Stacy, take over.
This is Mr. Marconi back at the invention of radio, invention of radio. JD and Stacy of Game On and Bloody Marys and Broadsheets, part of that Conservative Commando Radio Network here on 1360 AM WNJC, broadcasting live from Radio Row right now at CPAC. We'd like to welcome back all of our political geeks, freaks, and back alley sneaks up early this morning with us for a special live 1 hour broadcast. Because we love our WNJC audience so much, Stacy and I are going to be bringing a very packed hour. We are going to have Charles C.W. Cook, Askow of the Washington Examiner, and Robert Stacy McCain, baby, though he likes to have a couple cocktails, so we'll see if he's going to be making it down to that Radio Row by 10:45. Good morning, darling.
Good morning. How are you today?
oh, I need breakfast, I need coffee, I got to move my car out of the Gaylord Hotel. $40 a night.
$40 a night.
$40 a night for the overnight valet. You know what? I'd rather piss my money away at the Trump campaign. I mean, if you're going to waste it, if you're going to flush it down the toilet. And then for those of you who are very politically savvy and watching this election, we have Secret Service everywhere. Metal detectors for the first time. I think somebody's worried that somebody's going to be taking a shot at one of our guests. What do you think, baby?
I'm not sure, but I do know that Charles C.W. Cook told me he was stuck in a very long line. I told him to bypass it because the metal detectors weren't live yet, but I still don't see him coming down the aisle.
So this is the first year that Stacey and I have the privilege of broadcasting with 1360 WNJC here for CPAC. You can also find us on that K98talk.org. Tuesday nights, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thursday again, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard. We do Game On. Sunday morning, 11 a.m., baby, that Bloody Mary's and broadsheets. Your cure for that mainstream media hangover. And then 5 p.m. Drive Time. And leading into that Yahoo Sports, you can find Stacey and I again for another edition of Game On here on the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. So Stacey and I both got in last night. It's always a question of how are you going to get to D.C.? How are we going to get there? Me, personally, I drove and it was a nightmare. How about you, Dawn?
Traffic for us was actually excellent. Lou and I got up here from the North Carolina studios in record time and had a great time last night at what people like to call RhinoCon, and this year's theme was a tribute to Lindsey Graham.
You know, it was so Stacey and I are at this adult beverage purveying establishment last evening. And one of the things for anybody who has the opportunity to come back down to CPAC, Stacey and I have been saying it all the time. We highly recommend that you come down. There is plenty of time left. It's gonna be running today again, the 3rd through the 6th here at the Gaylord Hotel in National Harbor, Maryland. And you come down and yes, you wanna see the speeches, you wanna see the candidates, you wanna kinda rub elbows with the politico glitterati, as it were. And in this particular case, I think what people really need to understand that, especially that there is such a rift and a divide within the party right now, it really is a place where people of like-minded can come together, have a good time. You know, last night, Stacey and I hit the ground, showered. Well, not together, baby. Showered.
Please clarify that.
We got to get a bell up on the table. And, you know, we headed out and we hit a couple places. We saw a bunch of people that we've been lucky enough to meet at several conferences over the last year. And it really was just a good time. And again, for those of you who aren't familiar with CPAC, one of the things that really heartens me is the fact that it is such, you know, people don't understand this. I think a lot of people, when I heard CPAC, last year I was excited to come down, be on Radio Row, broadcast, but basically what I had a picture of in my mind was basically like the villages down in Florida, you know what I'm saying? A whole bunch of retired people just prattin' around going, hey, I want to have dinner at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. But it's not. It really is, if you could give them a picture of how much of a youth-driven event that it is.
Yeah, I mean, no, you come here and there are a ton of college activists. I know people like to think that we don't have a youth movement within the Conservative Party, but I would tell you, last year, what was it? They were all supporting Ben Carson and Rand Paul.
Oh, God.
And
if you were at CPAC last year, you would have thought that Dr. Carson
was a rock star.
He still is here.
What?
He still is here.
Oh, no, he's still a rock star here, and actually he'll be talking about his political future, I guess, here on Friday. So he's formally suspended his campaign and not doing the debate tomorrow night, but will be talking to us about what he will be doing in the future on Friday afternoon. So we'll talk a little bit about that when we're back on the air on Friday.
Stacey and I were lucky enough to run into Ben Carson last night at one of the events, and he actually gave us a little off-the-record interview. If you hold on 1 second, I just want to drop the audio of it. This is Dr. Ben Carson at the Public House in National Harbor, Maryland last night.
Yes, I'd like to thank all the people in the world today and the children and talk about my tax plan.
Come on.
And so another one leaves the race and one of JD's impressions will be gone from the repertoire.
No, they're staying. Stevie Wonder's not going anywhere. He's sticking around. You know who has? Oh, last night we had the most amazing conversation. So for anybody who doesn't know, John Kasich's father was a mailman. If you didn't know that.
He didn't work for FedEx?
No, no. John Kasich's father was a mailman. And last night at RhinoCon, there was a bunch of people. We were all outside. And I was like, did you guys know that John Kasich's father was a mailman? And everybody's riffing on these jokes about mailmen. And at some point, some guy comes over and he's like, I used to work for the Kasich campaign. And somebody's like, well, I guess you're unemployed now.
Well, and then I guess on Friday we're going to have somebody who worked for every campaign.
I don't know. I mean, that's the one thing. Everybody out there who does not have a Stacey, I highly recommend that you get yourself one. We hit the ground running yesterday. We needed to block 2 days' worth of interviews. We filled up today. And there's the security lines here, folks. I mean, it puts JFK at peak travel time to absolute shame. But right now we're waiting. We got a couple of our guests are hung up in security. I think the first one we're going to have for you this morning is that Charles C.W. Cook of that National Review, baby. Very good friend of J.D. and Stacey. And Game On that Conservative Commandos Radio Network on his 1360 WNJC. Followed up by that, we're going to have Ash Gow from the Chicago.
Wow.
I just moved to Chicago.
And he's had coffee.
Yeah, but it was one of those little... You want to know... Okay.
So, it was free.
So for any... So if the ACs... Well, anybody from the ACU who be listening to J.D. and Stacey right now on that 1360, baby, you got to listen. You guys are doing a phenomenal job. Phenomenal job. Things are a little more feng shuied, better than last year. There's a lot more flow and access to it. But the one thing that I would like to ask everybody who's sponsoring the event, please, in the media room where there's the coffee, bigger cups, please. Bigger cups.
Well, or just IV bags.
You're not supposed to tell him about that party. The horse will never be the same.
Oh, God. I must say, normally when JD and I broadcast, I am in the Atlanta studio and JD is in the Long Island studio. And broadcasting live in the same physical location is a completely different experience.
Well, I'd like to tell all the ladies in the listening office, whenever you get near JD, baby, it's the JD-ness. And it just kind of emanates. Are you getting some of them emanations? She's got emanations, baby. Yeah, emanations coming over. Emanations and machinations of politicization. Are you feeling it?
Oh, I'm feeling something. We're FCC governed right now, so I can't say exactly what it is.
Excuse me, radio co-host. Put your hands above the table so we can see what you're feeling.
Hey.
But the things get started very early here. You know, Stacey and I, we had the early 10 a.m. call to be on Radio Row. We stepped into the ballroom for the coffee, and they already had Journey Ernst up on stage speaking, and the ballroom is absolutely packed. You know, you go to a lot of conferences, no matter what the topic is, and you don't find great attendance, or you find people are there for a party, so they're not going to make the early events. I think Stacey and I have been guilty of that once or twice before. But today, I mean, that...
You normally make every speaker...
That room was absolutely packed right now for Joni Ernst.
Yeah, no, I mean, definitely more full than last year. It's completely reconfigured, and I think they were expecting some relatively large audiences. And I will tell you, the hallways are busier. I think people are a lot more energized this year.
And we're actually going to see how that energy breaks down. One of the things that I have been most interested in... Well, all right, let me paint a picture for everybody. So, the Gaylord Hotel in National Harbor, Maryland is huge. It's an absolutely... It is so big, you could put 500,000 Chinese people in here to make iPhones. That's how big this place is. I mean, there's several different conventions going on at once. And the security this year with the metal detectors and everything else is something we have yet to see. And I know it was something that Stacey and I were kicking around last night. Now, maybe because it's an election year, but last year you basically had, minus a few, probably about the same lineup of presidential candidates speaking, yet you didn't have this kind of security. And the difference between this year and last year is what?
They're actually presidential candidates and there's Secret Service involved.
I honestly wonder if the security isn't specifically for Donald Trump.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't say, and I know I like to be, I'm not saying that as a joke.
Tell him what happened last night. Oh, you weren't here yet, were you?
Well, I don't know.
I call her... Ricky Tiki Tavi.
Ricky Tiki Tavi, Rick Roberts, into that K98 talk, baby.
Hey, Lou and I are here. Let's go get our credentials. He goes, I'm being rushed from my room. The fire extinguisher is gone.
Oh! Okay.
So we all started CPAC with an evacuation.
While we're waiting for Charles to get through security, I had forgotten about that. So for anybody who wants to know about the political day from hell, so JD drives down from New York. It really should only be about a 4-hour drive. It took me about six. I hit some vicious traffic, and literally I pull up to the hotel last night, and the entire Gaylord Hotel, and this place is huge. I told you it could be an iPhone, a Chinese manufacturing facility. The entire place is sprawled out. And they're all standing in front of the valet. So I pull up, and I'm like, hey, man, what's going on? He's like, oh, we got a fire drill. I'm like, fire drill? I just drove for 6 hours. I got to use the restroom. So the guy goes, no, my friend, you know, it's this, that. I said, okay. And I said, I'm going. So I went. Nobody stopped me. Since everybody else was out of the hotel, there was one person left at the checkout desk. I'm like, hey, let me check in. So it, for fire safety, not so much. But for everything else, I think we're doing okay.
Well, no, we were all wondering which set of protesters had decided to put a fire in a trash can or some such thing.
Listen, I did that once, and it was only because I wanted to play with the matches. Hold on a second, folks. We have a whole bunch of live radio craziness going on here right now. Hi, guys. Can we help you out?
We just put our banner up.
Fantastic. All right. So we're going to continue here, but people are putting banners in places. We have no idea what's going on. So like I said, coming up, we're going to have Charles C.W. Cook in a few minutes. But the energy here is, I don't know, I feel like it's a different feel here from last year. It's a little, people seem to be a little more, it doesn't feel as, I think it feels a little more tense.
What I actually heard this morning and a little bit last night was that it was really too bad that John Oliver didn't have his Make Donald Trump Again hats available for people to get him in time to come here.
Oh, that would have been huge. That would have been huge.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan. This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had 4 dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
Think you've got a business. You didn't build that.
The feeling most people get when they hear a Barack Obama speech, I felt this thrill going up my leg. I don't have that too often.
Steady.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Ricky Robinson, host of America Off the Rails, will tackle the important issues facing America today as he tries to keep America from coming off the track. Get ready to hear the truth every Monday through Friday starting at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 Central, here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network.
Are you conservative in a world of liberal?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you're not alone. Hey, I'm Daniel Stafford, host of The Stafford Voice, and I'd like to invite you to tune in each Monday, 10 p.m. Eastern, where I'll break down the events of the week, and together we'll learn about how they affect you. So, sit back and get ready for the good, the bad, and the ugly of talk radio right here on K98 Talk.
From the Vikings of Norway to my home down south to Washington, D.C., I've been around. I've seen it all, and I've come out on top. You better beware, for all you know, the bell tolls for you. Enter the bell tower or watch your step. 8 p.m. Thursdays, K98 Talk.
for the second time in about 270 plus years, England is invading sovereign Charles American hair. Territory.
Good morning, Charles.
How are you doing? Hello.
We are doing
good.
Well.
How's that line?
Ladies and gentlemen, before we bring him in, I would just like to introduce, we are more than honored. If you do not know who this man is, my suggestion to you right now is to stop what you're doing. Open your front door, walk out into traffic, close your eyes, and stay there. Stay JD and Stacey here at WNJC 1360 AM are so happy, proud, and privileged to bring to you Mr. Charles C.W. Cook, baby, of that National Review. Good morning, Mr. Cook.
Hello, how are you?
Well, thank you. And yourself?
Yes, very well, very well. I finally got a good night's sleep.
Did you really?
I did,
and I'm an ass. So, we saw you. And we were like, all right, good. You know, let's check out. And Stacey was staying across the street, made sure she got home safely. So we come back here. You got to pass the bar before you get to the elevator to get to your room. So there's four of us. I'm like, why don't we have one more drink? And we did. And then they were about to close the bar. And in both the great American and British tradition, you can't have somebody close a bar and not buy a fresh drink. It's crazy.
It's illegal, I think.
And then there were some after-hours things. But we want to welcome you to the program. We'd like to ask you, this year, CPAC 2016, first and foremost, one, do you have anything right now that you're promoting, anything in the pipeline that you want people to start shooting the locks off their wallet, get ready to buy?
Well, my book is now out in paperback.
Is it really?
Yeah. So
I bought hardcover.
Thank you.
So it can be
has
thumbed.
A new chapter.
Does
it? I gotta buy it again.
There you go. It's not a long new chapter. It's just a little postscript.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was a crash course in capitalism. In merchandising, that's called a tease. That means I know that you bought the hardcover, and we appreciate it. But if you don't buy the soft cover, there's going to be a chapter of my brilliance that you're not going to understand. So we're not even going to have you talk about that chapter because we're going to have to let the cheapies go buy this.
Right,
okay?
Secret. Secret.
What do you see this year here as the most important driving issue to the base? Is it electability?
No. Is it? Evidently not.
All right, folks, thank you. That's our radio show for today.
nor is it sanity, I think.
No.
Yeah, no, actually, our station manager, Rick, has created a brand new hashtag called Make America Sane Again.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So
it's not going to happen.
As you know, Charles writes for National Review, and they had the issue called Against Trump. Talk to us a little about the reaction
Please.
To that and maybe the periodical stance.
Well, I think it was important for National Review and other conservatives to say ahead of time that we're against Trump, that this is not what conservatism stands for, that the Republican Party should not be taken in this direction, and that if it is to be taken in this direction, that there are dissenters. People have asked me, well, what exactly did you intend to achieve? Well, obviously we wanted to influence, that's why we exist. But you can't always convince people to change their mind. Mm-hmm. You can, however, draw a line in the sand. And the resistance, if that's not too grandiose a word here, is going to be key because the Democratic Party and the left in general have for years pointed to people like Donald Trump and said, well, that's what conservatives believe. They're really just bigots. They're really just racist. They don't really have any policies. It's just resentment and bombast and bluster, and it's not. And when you have someone like Thomas Sowell writing in National Review, it's very, very difficult to point to a man like Thomas Sowell and say, you are Donald Trump. But only if he's done it. And so he had to, we had to get on the record now and try to make our case.
Well, let me ask you a question, because it was interesting the word that you used, and it was, I want to excise the Republican Party because they're basically the Whigs. Let's just talk about conservative. And when you speak about a quote-unquote direction to be taken, is it so much, and we're not dancing around the issue, we are talking about the anomaly of Donald Trump and his front-runner status. Is it so much that he's trying to take conservatism in a direction, or is he so viciously fracturing, splitting, and blowing up the party that there really isn't a direction? Because when I look at Donald Trump, I couldn't, past his history of being a New York liberal, I couldn't tell you what direction he would take anything. I don't think the man's going to be Reagan, but I don't know whether he would appoint Scalia or whether he would appoint Obama.
Right. Well, I don't think that he has a great direction. And I think that's worrying for two reasons. Firstly, because conservatism is based on principles and hard truths. It's based on an understanding of human nature, that men can be good and must be free, but that they should never be given too much power.
Mm-hmm.
It's built upon an understanding of how the world works, which is not how the world should work. And it's built on a set of abstract but real ideas that have made America powerful and successful. And
I'm so glad you didn't say "Make America Great Again." I really, Charles.
So it's important that we don't allow Trump to hijack the one party that tries to direct those principles. But it's also important because we're not entirely sure what it is that he believes. Now, on the bottom end of my fear is that he'll bring the party back to where it was in the 1970s, that it will essentially be a rudderless, directionless American Tory party that wants to deliver goods and money and influence to a slightly different portion of the electorate than the Democratic Party does. That's the best case scenario.
It's funny that you said that, because if you look at his dealings, and again, my background before I came into this was Wall Street and commercial real estate, and you know, I have had some dealings with, not with him personally, but with the organization. And you know, one of the questions that I think becomes is when you talk about the Republican Party, you know, kind of, would you compare them to the Tories? Is that what you...
Well, during the 1970s, under Nixon and then Ford, yes.
Well, my question was, so if you look at his business record, and it even goes to his public statements and debates, he's talking about, well, I donate to politicians of all stripes because basically this is what I'm getting for my money.
I find that...
Are we heading to... So, I mean, if you go back historically, you have McKinley and they bury Teddy Roosevelt as Veep so that he can't mess with the trust. Then some nationalist shoots McKinley, he dies, and Teddy Roosevelt says, no more robber barons. Could we be seeing... And for some reason, I hope it's the right analogy. If you look at Teapot Dome and the cronyism that went from government into that scandal, and how long you had to have business leaders institutionalized within the party in order to have that grow up. And it was, Teapot Dome was basically protectionist. It had a lot to do with industry and tariffs. That is, do you see any, that is my fear, is that he basically, with a smoke and mirrors, almost Aldous Huxley, like Brave New World, everybody just takes some Soma, go see a feely. If you don't like it, step into a suicide booth. Because me and the people I've been doing business with for the last 40 years, we got this.
In a sense, I think what he's doing is he's indulging a cop-out. I mean, there is a real and legitimate criticism of the government that is usually forwarded by conservatives. And that criticism goes a little bit like this. The federal government is now so big and so powerful and so extensive that it is a natural hive of corruption. Now, the conservative critique is, well, then we need to limit government's influence. Donald Trump's critique is, I need to run it because I'm unimpeachable. Now, I don't know whether he is pretending that he's unimpeachable. He is, of course, unimpeachable. All humans, impeachable, all humans are. But I don't know whether he's pretending for his own good. But this is not how you should be selling to the right a solution to that problem. I mean, it's cheap.
How are you?
It's a poor and intellectually bankrupt way of dealing with that problem. Because rather than having to actually do the hard work of limiting government, rather than having to accept that we can't continue on like this if we want the government to be corrupt, Trump has come uncorrupt. Trump has come along and he said, well, of course there is a problem and I had to take advantage of that when I was running a business, but the way to fix it is to put me in and I will be perfect. It's essentially, and I don't mean to compare him directly to this, at least yet, but it's essentially,
we're getting there.
Dictator idea, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that, well, you don't have to give up any of the power, you just have to find the right king.
But that,
we would reject an enlightened despot, but we'll take an unenlightened
one. But doesn't that dovetail completely? And I don't know if, I thought I saw this in two different places, so I'm not sure if it only ran in Politico, but within the last week of 10 days, there was a political pollster pollster. There was a political pollster.
I did it again.
There was a guy who asked people questions and took down the percentages.
Systematic sense.
Thank you. And what he said is he picked on something that was a similarity in Trump supporters that nobody else had. And the reason was, with a psychology background, he asks questions that most political guys with percentages questions don't. And that has to do with authoritarianism. And it was this fascinating layout that across age, gender, income, even political party, that the one thing that was statistically significant with Trump supporters was they either tended to be authoritarians themselves, or they were really looking for somebody to go, it's broken, please give me the rules so I can follow them and fix it. And I is with how badly the conservative movement has been let down by the Republican Party as we sit here in 2016, is the conservative movement itself, not just some people, not 20 or 30%, is the movement versus the party in danger of being hijacked? Or is this a seminal moment for the party where, with the leadership of National Review, people who believe in these principles are saying no? How do you see it?
Well, I hope it's the latter. On your authoritarianism point, both sides have a tendency toward authoritarianism and in different ways. The right has always pushed in times of economic hardship toward the Nixon figure, the law and order figure, the man who says he'll fix things, and conservatives have tended to push it back in the other direction. On the left, there are people on the left who are against authority. They're the 60s radicals, they're the pacifists, they're the anti-war people. But then this social justice movement seems to yield a good number of authoritarians in their own way, who want people to bake cakes and so forth, if not more. And just be quiet. They're anti-speech, they're anti-politics in some way. Now, I think that what is going to happen next, and this is a cop-out answer, I suppose, is going to define the next 10, 15 years. It is possible that Donald Trump will not just have staged a hostile takeover of the Republican Party, but of the conservative movement, if the conservative movement believes that it is more important to beat Hillary Clinton, to continue as it has been operating, than to take on Donald Trump. For my money, that would be a vast and time-altering mistake.
Well, so did you see Tom Nichols' article where he described the Hamilton rule, and it's easier to coalesce against a common enemy than it is to divide amongst yourself? Is that kind of your thought process as well in terms of taking on that particular individual?
I am worried about the right's capacity to stand up and say no when there is a second enemy. a second enemy who may in some ways be less palatable than the first enemy. Nevertheless, the right has been successful in doing that at various points in its history. Mm-hmm. I mean, conservatives are more principled than progressives think we are.
Oh, absolutely.
Over and over again, I see people on the left saying, you'll endorse him. Now, I'm of the view that I will never back him. They will see me stick with that through thick and thin, but they don't believe it. Now, I don't think that's because they think I'm particularly weak. I don't think that's because they think that National Review in general or conservatives are bad people. I think it's because their movement is built on delivering results to certain constituencies and not clear ideological ideals, whereas conservatives in general tend to be more ideological. They tend to have a stronger compass. Whether they are right will define the future of American history, and I hope they're wrong.
We're speaking right now, if you're just joining us, with Charles C.W. Cook of National Review, author of the Conservatarian Manifesto, out now in paperback. So wait, does it still have the red cover?
It still has the red cover.
Ladies and gentlemen, it has taken about 60 plus years. The conservatives finally have their own little red book to put in their back pocket, right around on their bicycle,
written
a little green
by
suit.
A bearded foreigner.
Wait, does the book come with a really bad bicycle and a bland gray suit?
Absolutely. There's also an audible version too, which I read.
Do you narrate it?
So if you feel like spending 6.5 hours with me in the car,
Only if you
do it for only $10.
Take a road trip with Charles.
Exactly.
I honestly, awesome. I have a theory on and especially engaging about this. We've been lucky enough to have Charles on the program before. He's a very fun guy, whether you have him here, you get all his insight, or whether you're just talking to him in a restaurant or a bar. Well, I always thought, and this is just the real skelly capitalist in me, I always thought people that did audiobooks should do two versions. So if you sell the one audiobook version at $35.99, whatever, there should be a $50 audio version of whoever is doing the book hammered. Like, you should cut two of them.
Like Drunk History.
Absolutely.
Like Red Eye for the entire book reading.
Mm-hmm. Like, you know, like 3 o'clock in the morning when you wake up and you're just in a AM radio, and you're in a really foul mood, and you just, if you could just go, chapter 6, I don't care if you like it or not, and just, kind of start going.
You're my best friend, but you're my best friend. I don't even like Obama.
Hey, Obama, this chapter's for you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Charles C.W. Cook of the National Review. If you have it in hardcover, buy the paperback edition, the Conservative Manifesto.
Yes,
otherwise, you won't get that other chapter. Shoot the walk off your wallet, you cheap hooples. Charles, thank you very, very much. And in typical Radio Row style, this is like speed dating. Speed dating for conservatives. We have the absolutely drop-dead gorgeous and even more so than she is beautiful, brilliant Eschow.
Hello.
Good morning, darling.
How are you?
Still with the Washington Examiner?
Yes, I am.
See, I remember things.
And Ash got to stand in the really long and disgusting line.
Oh, did they make you, really?
Well, not the super long line, but the media line is incredibly long down there. They've got like one person, one printer. They're printing the badges out.
Oh, you didn't grab... See, I knew enough from that. You just got yours printed out today?
Yes.
I did this last night. Well,
normally they have everything printed out.
Well, did you want to? Did I still have the sign on the desk downstairs that says you can't lose it this year? We don't replace it. So I walk in, and it's all done by kids, and I'm like, this is BS. And they're like, what? And I'm like, I'm going to lose my media pass. I'm like, you have to replace it. You absolutely have to replace it. And they're like, oh, well, yeah, we'll see. But good morning, Ash. Welcome. We are so happy you're glad to join us. I hope you don't mind. I think with the way that the time is going, we might have you on a panel this morning with the gentleman standing right next to you, Mr. Robert Stacey McKay. What do you think? Should we do a little 1360 AM panel here? Does that work for you, Ash?
Sure.
Oh, grab a chair, pull it over. It's Gonzo Radio right now, Stacey. I don't even know how to unwrap this. Why don't you take this and give Stacey that?
Oh. There you go. You just want me to take this because then I got to move closer to you.
Now we have the beautiful Ash Gow joined by Robert Stacey McCain. Good morning, everybody.
Rumors
Good
of his morning. Demise have been greatly exaggerated.
Completely greatly exaggerated. Before we get started, I want to find out first, Ash, do you have anything right now that the American public needs to shoot the lock off their wallet, get ready to buy that you have coming out, or anything you want to promote?
Oh, not yet. I mean...
Not yet.
Sometime this year, but
that's
nothing.
A tease. That's a tease. You thinking about a book?
People have been asking me to write one for quite a while now. So,
what would your topic be?
Well, it would be about the campus hysteria, whether it's campus sexual assault, free speech, these whole idea of microaggressions and safe spaces,
did you take about away from that incident with Ben Shapiro out in California?
Well, that's exactly what we're talking about.
That's got to be the worst I've heard of.
Students don't want to hear opposing opinions. They specifically don't want to hear conservative opinions, and they definitely don't want to hear the opinion of anybody who tells them that they need to grow up and seriously, this whole microaggression suggestion where, you say America is the land of opportunity, well, that's somehow racist now, and that's somehow offensive to people, and that's going to hurt somebody so bad that they're going to not be able to focus on their schoolwork or something like that. Like, it's just this infantilization of our college students these days, and for Ben Shapiro to go out there and to, basically say, like, grow up, and for them to be like, no, we can't, and like they're with the protests, weren't there fights?
When yeah, there's like no, no. Actual, but I mean, I am proud to
violence
say
violence from the people that are claiming that words are violent.
I am proud to say I have two college age daughters, and two of the people they read are you and Base Mom.
Yeah, I think that's pretty good. But speaking about censorship and people not wanting to hear the conservative side of the issue, we want to bring in somebody who is in a virtual intellectual prison of sorts by them social media liberals, baby. That Mr. Robert Stacey McCain. Good morning, Stacey.
It's good to be on with you.
It's great to have you. So listen, everybody out there, Robert definitely is not dead or anything. He is here. He is very much alive and in the flesh. He's got a smile right now that would choke everybody who misses him on Twitter. Why don't you give us a little background of what happened? Bring us up to speed on the whole deal. And
well, on February 19th, my Twitter account, at R.S. McCain, was
very popular.
Suspended. Yes, yes. It was. I've had the account since 2009. It was suspended without warning or notice. And when I inquired, you know, what was going on, I was told that I had been, quote, participating in targeted abuse.
But it took forever for them to finally give you a reason, right?
Right, right. You have to appeal, and so, then it took a
couple days. Oh, they just aced you, and then you didn't know why, and you had to kept pressing, and then finally they said, this is why.
Yes, I
well, he makes fun of Amanda Marcotte.
Oh, no. I'm a big fan of
makes fun of Amanda Marcotte.
I know.
Well, here's the thing.
And Jessica Valenti.
Probably, yeah. You know, if I had to guess, you know, where this came from, it was probably someone associated, you know, with the people who are against Gamergate. You know what mm-hmm. Gamergate is. And so that had attracted a lot of social justice warriors, as they are called, who claimed that they're victims of harassment because they speak out for women and minorities and stuff like this. And so, you know, but it's gotten to the point, as Ash was talking about, not only are people afraid of opposing ideas, but when you try to talk to them, that they claim that they are victims of harassment. Mm-hmm. You know, is that if you disagree with a feminist, well, this makes you a misogynist, and it makes her a victim.
I know, I'm a misogynist. Can you believe
now,
it?
Now, Ash,
internalized misogyny.
Do you find, so with the vitriol and just the hoople-headed nonsense that gets thrown at Stacey from the feminist left, do you find, because, I mean, you guys swim in kind of the same waters as far as top, would you agree with that, as far as ish?
Yeah, we don't agree on everything.
Right, but I mean, ish.
Nobody agrees 100% with me, except
possible.
I saw a guy in the mirror this morning that agreed with me 100%.
Do you
on everything, that guy too?
I always agree with myself because I'm completely right.
Do you see a difference in the way that people the way that the left comes after a female who's saying what you're saying and a male for saying what he's saying?
I think that there is. I personally, Robert is much better at irking them than I am. I try to stay away from that, which helps.
Keep your Twitter account?
Yeah. I mean, kind of, you know, irk them sometimes, but I try to stay, which is also why I don't have as many followers as, you know, everybody else. But you still see it with Christina Hoff Sommers as well.
Oh, she's fabulous.
She doesn't irk them as much as, you know, someone like Robert does.
Oh, but I mean, she'll still go on a college campus.
Milo as well.
But she'll still go on a campus and require security.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, on Twitter, it might be a little bit different, but, you know, you still get the kind of protests and everything. So, but there is a difference between the men and the women, because they would like to just ignore the women saying these things because it goes against their narrative that all women agree with them because all women just want to have abortions and free birth control.
Same concept of like a feminist Uncle Tom for like the radicalized, you know, black
left.
Well,
I mean, you know, there's people like myself and Politibunny and some others that are a little bit more outspoken.
See, she's a good feminist. She don't mind when I go like this. She's one of them fun feminists.
That's the What is that about? You just make
no, but he just likes to bug me. But I mean, for those of us who tend to be outspoken or say, no, you're not a victim, or grow up in very specific right. terms, I mean, we are, oh, the things we are called by other women. I mean, it's just amazing. And in general, the progressive left for outspoken conservative women is horrible.
Well, that's what they say, that this is harassment and that they are harassed, and they use the exact same tactics against conservatives and are like, well, I'm not harassing you. Like, what are you talking about?
We're
like,
disagreeing.
Their rules don't apply to them, and mm-hmm. they never have. Mm-hmm.
You can never say that it is wrong to say that liberals don't have standards. They have exactly two, one for them and one for everybody else. Going back many years, Michelle Malkin actually wrote a book about this called Unhinged, talking mm-hmm. about the way the left attacked during the Bush years, especially. You know, she was called some of the vilest things, and the things that they people say about Ann Coulter and other, you know, the more.
Well, Ann's starting to earn it these days, in my opinion.
If you are a woman and you appear on Fox News, the left just hates you simply because you're a woman and you're on Fox News. And they do this, and you learn to just block it, and, you know. You know, shut it, because they will come after you. You know, Ash is one
well, all
people.
Women, all minorities, and all people with alternative lifestyles are Democrats. You didn't know that?
Right.
It's in the book. It's in the rule book.
Yeah.
It's the social
right.
justice warrior
well,
book that
well,
you
have. So if you don't agree, you're not really right. part of that.
Yeah. I'm not really a woman.
I'm not really a woman. Exactly.
Yeah. Woman is now an ideology instead of a biological condition.
If that's the case, I'm a true believer, baby.
I grew up. With people who called themselves feminists on the television mm-hmm. and what they were talking about. I mean, I was a kid, right? But what they were talking about was not what they talk about today. They were talking about a woman's right to express her opinion. They were talking about a woman's right to enter the boardroom or, you know, choose the career
nowadays,
she wanted to choose. Now it's like,
they don't, they've got
shut
all
up.
Of that stuff. So they're just, you say, they have to invent new rights for women. The new thing.
No, special privileges. Those aren't even, those right. aren't even equality.
They're claiming their right that we somehow mm-hmm. have a right to free birth control or without a copay, which we all know is stupid because your deductible and your premium went up to pay for it. So, it, you know, whatever. But you've got politicians out in California trying to remove sales tax from tampons for equality. You've got the new thing now is there's a company in the UK that is offering period leave to women so that they could take a couple days off a month.
So we can only work three weeks.
Thanks, folks. JD's done with radio for the week.
And so, like, you're just getting to this ridiculous thing where this whole thing in the name of equality is actually just special privileges, because there's things that women deal with that men don't deal with. There's things that men deal with that women don't deal with. But because, like,
men have to deal with women.
Complain about the biological things that make us a woman.
I like people telling me I don't know I'm oppressed.
Right. Oh, yeah.
You haven't figured it out yet.
It's false consciousness.
I get to do anything I want at my job, work, and I get paid good money for it, and somehow I'm oppressed. Like, I'm sorry. Like, I'm making it in my life, and I'm less than under 30 years old. I'm not oppressed.
And you travel and you meet interesting people.
I would say that I have more privilege than some similarly situated men, because people are now so afraid of women, so afraid that a woman's going to accuse them of something. So, like, women just basically can show up and just get, yeah, the road just clears for them. Mm-hmm.
And for those of you who are just joining us, we are very privileged to have right now Robert Stacey McCain and Ash Schau of the, Washington Examiner. Let me ask you a question. Where can, everybody right now, you get over to you in Facto Machine and you get over to The Other McCain. That's two C's, baby, like credit card, CC. TheOtherMcCain.com. You're going to get over there because you're going to be wanting to free yourself some Stacey. What I'd like to ask the both of you is tell the audience where they can find the bulk of what you guys have been writing. And what I'd like to ask the two of you, because, you know, and Stacey and I really want to bring this to the audience. We have the opportunity to run into you guys at conferences. We have the opportunity after hours to sit down and, you know, have these conversations. And, you know, you can see how smart and brilliant these two are in their writing, but they really are just incredibly, incredibly smart people. They take their topics very seriously. And when you guys were talking about the left, and when you where the left really doesn't want to hear the other point of view,
Is there anybody on the issues that you guys are advocating from a conservative viewpoint? Do you guys have counterweights on the left anymore to have rational conversations, thoughts, debates, or no? Because you're are the only two who are actually reading and thinking, because the day you went to the university, well, here you go, baby. This is written 1972. These are the rules. Rules. White man, bad. Marriage, bad. Traditional family, bad.
I can't think of anybody on the left that on these topics can actually sit down, because they just always devolve into saying that you're pro-rape, that you have internalized misogyny. They start
made up concepts that have festered in university campuses for about a decade.
Once they have they don't have an argument to come back with, they just start throwing out names.
Yeah, it's name calling. Is that, you're a misogynist, you're a homophobe, you're a patriarchal oppressor. And what Ash has done in staying on this beat about the 1 in 5 number that's thrown around in terms of that, this phony claim that 20% of college women are rape victims. And, I've written a post about this called The Campus Rape Shortage, because they've hired all these sexual assault counseling type people, and they go looking for, the
problems,
cases, and they don't have any cases.
They're a solution.
Stacey is not advocating that there is a shortage of rapes on campus. just to be clear, audience.
Exactly. You see, it doesn't match up to the 1 in 5 number. The actual reported case is never going to amount to that. And then they claim, well, most cases aren't reported.
Was this your last tweet before you
No,
dropped?
But you see that on February 9th, I did call Anita Sarkeesian a totalitarian ideologue.
Which she is.
That is so nice for some of the things that you have called people. I mean, are you telling me they all got in a room and they read? I mean, what did you have, like 100,000 tweets? They went through 100,000 tweets and went, give me this, hold on a second. They went through 100,000 tweets and went, can't get him for that. Totalitarian ideologue. That's over the thing there. Well, he's got to go.
It was more the person, Anita Sarkeesian.
Well, she's on the council, right?
Well, yeah, you can read. There's a quote there if you wanted to read that. Turn the page. Okay. Do you see that quote from my book? Read that.
In order to obtain?
Yes.
In order to obtain the androgynous equality that is the objective of feminist ideology, religious freedom will have to be abolished along with the free speech rights of feminism's critics. Unless we are willing to oppose feminism now, we may find ourselves eventually living in a totalitarian society where such opposition is prohibited by law.
That's from my book, Sex Trouble, Radical Feminism and the War Against Human Nature. Mm-hmm. And when you talk about, and you're talking about the feminist you knew growing up, what you thought of as feminism, what I thought of as feminism.
Well, and I'd say Christina Summers fits that role.
Right.
I mean,
right.
She's a reasonable advocate for women and women's issues, and she still has to get security when she goes on college campuses.
Reason is not allowed on campus anymore.
Do you now have to do that? Because, when you were starting on the issue, I'm sure it was easy to move around campus as a young reporter and blend in. But, now that you have some profile, do you find it tougher to be on campuses?
I'm telling you, I don't have profile. I was speaking at a college campus last week, and nobody showed up to oppose
me. Let's get Ash some profile.
Yeah.
That's the thing. I'm telling you that I'm not an example of all
I'll bust
them
in.
I don't get hate mail. I don't get called nasty.
Everybody right now, start getting some hate mail and nasty phone calls to Ash, please, so that she's fine.
Because we have to prepare Ash for when she does get profile, so just start trolling.
Tell us the next time that you're speaking. Stacey won't shower for a week. She'll grow her pits out. I'll get some hipster haircut. I can't fit into anything that even remotely is called skinny jeans, but I'll do my best, and then we'll go down to a college campus.
We'll protest you.
We'll
give you profile.
We'll be like the old
get your nose pierced.
That's
important.
It'll be fun, but I don't get the hate. I'm just simply ignored or unknown. So, when it comes to the harassment, it's so rare for me to have anybody get
hit. Well, let's change that. How can all the Code Pink protesters find Ash? How can they find what she writes so it aggravates them? And what are some of your upcoming appearances so they can go get signs and stink like patchouli?
I will be speaking at a conference later this year, but it hasn't quite been announced yet, so I'll let you guys know further. But
and if the gamers get together, you're always there.
Well, yeah, I will be at AirPlay, too, which is, I believe, going to happen in August in Tampa, I think, this year. So
Tampa? I don't even know where the conference is. I'm going.
Right. Last year it was in Miami, and now this year is in Tampa. It's
I've got
a wonderful
family in Florida.
Wait.
Tampa, Miami, if the third year is in New York, who's ever organizing it is a cocaine trafficker.
Right. No, so beyond that, you can read my work at thewashingtonexaminer.com, or you can also find my political non-campus coverage at theobserver.com.
Stacey, where can they find the book right now?
The book is on Amazon,
okay,
and it's called Sex Trouble, Radical Feminism, and the War Against Human Nature. My blog is theothermccain.com, and I also write for The American Spectator at spectator.org.
And if you're on that social media, on the Twitters, you have got to carry a hashtag. I'd ask that you carry it in your bio. Try to send it out with as many tweets as possible. That is hashtag free, F-R-E-E, for those of you that went to public school. Stacy, S-T-A-C-Y, and you make sure that you make your voice heard. Maybe your account gets suspended too, but what the hell do you want to be on a First Amendment platform that doesn't want your speech?
Yeah, we're lining up with some great people when we support Stacy McCain, because we have Glenn Reynolds, also known as that Instapundit, who's a huge supporter. Adam Baldwin actually went berserk.
Aaron Worthing. He's been out there fighting the good fight for you. I'll be honest.
Good and excellent people.
You find a catalog of both Robert and Ash's work, you will not be disappointed. We want to thank the both of you so much. Listen to me, you out-of-work, unemployed, social justice Democrats. You keep your Google. You keep it set for Ash. You find out where she's going to be. Will you go protest her, please? Give us some media like Ann Coulter so that we can have a serious person actually writing a book instead of this blonde, crypt-keeping puppet. Thank you very much, guys. We really appreciate
thanks for having
it.
Me.
This has been Robert Stacy McCain and Ash Gowan, 1360 AM. WNJC, 1360 AM.
You occupy freaks with your glitter bombs. Bring it on! Bring on the glitter. Everything has changed. Everything has changed in the last few years. Conservatives used to take it, and we're not taking it anymore.
If you want to work until you keel over, have less of everything in retirement, or give back more of your hard-earned money to the stock market again, then just ignore me. But if you'd like to protect the money you save, receive a steady, predictable retirement income, and enjoy financial security for as long as you live, then listen to this. You can download a free report that reveals the wealth-building secrets Wall Street and the banks don't want you to know. You'll learn how you can get guaranteed growth, safety, and real prosperity without risking your money in the Wall Street casino, and how to get the money you need when you need it, simply by asking for it. This is the best way to have a 100% secure retirement and know your money will last as long as you do. To learn more about this method and to get your free report, go to 29security.com. That's the number 29security.com. 29security.com. Go to 29security.com. If you want to work until you keel over, have less of everything in retirement, or give back more of your hard-earned money to the stock market again, then just ignore me. But if you'd like to protect the money you save, receive a steady, predictable retirement income, and enjoy financial security for as long as you live, then listen to this. You can download a free report that reveals the wealth-building secrets Wall Street and the banks don't want you to know. You'll learn how you can get guaranteed growth, safety, and real prosperity without risking your money in the Wall Street casino, and how to get the money you need when you need it, simply by asking for it. This is the best way to have a 100% secure retirement and know your money will last as long as you do. To learn more about this method and to get your free report, go to 29security.com. That's the number 29security.com. 29security.com. Go to 29security.com.